very similar to the educational achievement authority in Detroit, that could actually go into school buildings and take over operations. Depending on how that discussion goes, I think it's something we're going to want to keep an eye on. And don't forget that when they take resources out of state aid to do these things, and much of the discussion about the resources that are going to be necessary in Detroit, which could calculate to about $100 per student for 10 years from each district in our state, to this type of structure where they get potential additional funding to address low performing schools. Of course, we Macomb County has worked quite hard and assisted a number of districts in coming out of state oversight, and I think has demonstrated the ability within the county to use resources at hand to address the needs. I think we should all be looking at the governor's proposals and the state recommendation in these matters, and talking to your legislators and making sure that they understand your position on public education in Macomb County and in the state. It's something worth watching. It's moving very quickly. Anything else on legislative matters?
I have a comment about it. I've been doing a lot of thinking, and the difference, it's always bothered me, the difference between districts within our own county, that's the amount of money you receive. If you calculated that we all got what we, what some districts in our city, we wouldn't have any issue. We'd be out of, over the years, I don't know how much that has cost us in the last decade or so. And I was wondering if we could entertain maybe pressing some of our legislators to draft some legislation that would allow you, at least within your own county, to pass a local millage that would equalize what each particular district in the county is getting, so that it comes out. It couldn't be any more than that, and it would change as that changed, but what it does, it makes it even playing field. So if you're living on one side of the street and you're, another student's on the other side of the street, there's thousands of dollars difference between those kids, and they live in the same communities. They, we pay the same taxes. So what started out as a good idea, I think needs tweaked. It may not be the ultimate correction for financing schools. We've had three different formulas. In the 52 years I've been involved in education, it's changed three major times. It's never got it quite right. But I think a piece of legislation would allow you within your own county, it would be a vote, people would say no, but it would allow us to equalize the playing field so that what Madison Heights or South Lake or is getting, we could get that amount. It would be somebody in the county, and that's the benchmark each county would have. So I don't know. I think it's a kind of legislation people are so frustrated. We waited 10 years to get this right, 12 years maybe. You remember when this went through, Jackie? 1995, so it's more like 20 years. And they haven't figured it out yet. So I'm tired of us trying to make decisions that was a legislative issue, and we're trying the best we can. And we're not talking about Massachusetts, we're not talking about Indiana, Illinois, we're talking about Macomb County, making it even, and giving the communities the right to do that. If they say no, they say no. But I think there's some power back to the local school board, the local community to work that way. It's just something I've been thinking about a lot, because I've been studying something out of state, what do you say, finance? And
that's a great idea to contact the legislator from your experience. And you carry a lot of knowledge with you. When you speak to a legislator that likely hasn't been there with a number of maybe 4 or 6 years, to talk to them about the impact and the history and the opportunities for changes, I think you could be a resource for the legislator.
Well, I think that giving the playing field is a wonderful idea, and that can make it would be fantastic if they do it at the legislative level. People in this community are already upset. 10% of our population is schools of choice. And you're going to ask our community for more money to pay for 10% of students that don't live here?
Well, that's where the legislation could be tweaked. Those are things I've been thinking about. If you happen to vote votes on it and you don't live in a residency, then there could be a per capita tax applied to you like they do in some other states. So you may not live, you are that school, then you get a per capita tax, so equal the amount that the taxpayer in that district would give. So
So there would be, they don't get a vote on that, but you, this is where the legislation has to look and crunch those numbers. Some states, many are 18, you pay after capita tax for education. I remember getting my bill in Pennsylvania, I was going to college, and that got me an exemption, but it jarred me to think, I gotta pay all this money, and I didn't have a, you know, I just had enough job to get gas in my car at the time. So, but that, there's different ways that schools be financed, but if we can find a way to give a little bit more back to school, I knew this district, I know what some of these parents are paying for lessons in music, and lessons in karate, and lessons, you know, and extra clubs. You know, I think the majority of other kids in there, it wouldn't be that much, it would be very little, but it would equalize. When you spread it out over the district, it would give us a chance. We would be laying off teachers, we could reinstate some programs. It's just, we need to find a way to think creative, out of the box. Michigan sometimes is slow to really look out and want to change to somebody else's idea. I just thought,
I'm one of those parents that pays for the lessons for music and pays for the lessons for karate and paid the ice bill for the hockey team and paid the pay-to-play for the cross. I paid all those things, and I can tell you, even today, it still grinds my bones that I'm the one paying while other kids are not. Other kids will pay the same thing.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
It grinds my bones.
School of choice is a problem.
That I would be paying $140 for my kid to play lacrosse while the kid next to me has the new phone, the new shoes, the new everything, and they're paying nothing. So I think if you're looking at a village, we're working on the country.
Okay. And please contact your legislators and give your opinion. Sharon?
Absolutely. Contact your legislators and give your opinion and give it forcefully. As to the comments about school choice, I think the last interview before, we absolutely had an employee of the district who doesn't live here, whose children are school of choice children. Well, they're not paying the taxes. They are bringing in the FTE for their students, and that is a number that I do not want us to ever forget because it makes a difference.
Yeah.
Okay. The other comment is, as far as the legislature, when they did this back in 1995, I don't know about you guys, but I thought the plan was to level the playing field when they were doing this. That was the game plan. What ended up happening was you got frozen wherever you were at. And you guys, you know, come on, if you are getting 10K and 95 for your students, you got to keep it. How fair is that for everybody else? I say that's a hugely unlevel playing field. And I say, instead of coming back from taxpayers, I'd ask them to give some more. I get what you're saying, Ken, and you know, in a different time and place, it might be okay, but to come back to the taxpayers and say, yeah, you know what, so you need to pay some more because we keep screwing up with your money. No. Fix what you're supposed to fix in 95. Level the sinking playing field. Really level. And then let's see what we can all do. Oh, by the way, Troy County schools, everyone needs to take 50 or 100 bucks per student across the state to pay for that. How are we already doing without that happening to us?
The problem we're having, though, half of the streets, we're in the middle. Half the district above us want to keep the way it is, and the other half want more money. And they set this up at the state level, so it's like we're fighting each other. So in reality, if it gets a conversation looking at that, if that's the way that they level out the field, if we come up with it, it gets the debate going. But I feel we have a broken system, it's an unfair system, and it's unfair to the districts who are, like us, who have done a great job on our infrastructure, passed bonds, done all the right things, and we're almost penalized because of it.
Based on the statement that we are fighting each other, having school of choice, we are penalizing weak districts to support our district or Birmingham is whatever. But it's I truly believe instead of penalizing districts, we should work to support each other as a coalition instead of, well, we want these students and we want those students and we offer this, they're going to come here. We should be more of a united group in Macomb County and work to support each other.
That's what it's good for, supporting the United States. The meeting format, we got short in the last meeting. This district could send a letter to our legislators and the governor at one time indicating we wanted a reevaluation of school of choice, the impact of districts, and to reevaluate it. Now, part of the discussion, would this board be, would there be consensus on this board to re-sign that letter as today's date and to send it to, again, our legislators and the governor to reevaluate the impact of school choice, to ask them to do a thorough investigation of what's happened to the funding structure and the environment of the school districts. And I believe we have that letter that was distributed. I would propose that we use basically the same language, just with updated signatures. Is there a consensus on that, or would you want to review that letter before?
Let's reissue
that letter and make sure, and if there's any recommended changes, please send them forward so we can get this done as soon as possible. Okay?
I just wanted to clarify one thing. It was a comment from a few minutes ago, but just to clarify, schools of choice students pay and participate fees as well, and I just wanted to make sure people knew that. The way school districts are funded in the state of Michigan, the way school districts are funded in the state of Michigan right now, the majority of school districts receive their money from the state. We levy 18 mills on non-homestead property, which is business, which are our businesses, and the balance of the money comes from the state. And that's where we get almost all of our money, and almost every school district does that. So then the question becomes, where does the state get enough money to pay all of us? They levy 6 mills on all of our property residents, so across the board. And the reason I bring that up is because whether you're a schools of choice parent or whether you're a district parent, the state of Michigan is taking 6 mills from all of us, putting it in a pot, as well as a portion of income tax, a portion of sales tax, and a bunch of other places. They create a big pot of money called the state aid fund, and then they distribute it inequitably, which of course is part of our frustration. But everyone who is a homeowner is paying in that 6 mils to the state that then comes back to each district. So we're all paying. There are a few districts that are an exception that actually levy a millage on residents. And it is a tricky explanation. It's only a few districts, so it's probably not worth talking about right now. But the reason I brought this up is because in general, and this is not related to the bond issue, bond money is entirely different, but as it relates to operating in general, we are all paying, because we are paying sales tax, we are paying income tax, we are paying the 6 mils. It's all going into the bucket of the state, and they're writing us all checks. And I just want to clarify that things like pay to participate, lunches, things like that, all of the kids pay equally.
I would like in that letter something about the funding of universities through the state aid, where they get far more money than we do, and they also have tremendous donations.
And the ability to raise the cost on a yearly basis.
They can raise their costs up and down as much as they
want. And have them.
And we don't have that luxury.
All right, I think that's a good question.
We're past new business. Can we go back there?
No, we've got time frame, and we're past it, and we've got closed session to come in, and I'd like to make it a closed session. So,
thank you. So, if you don't mind, you want to go ahead and shut down the session.
Okay, we're going to next time our calendar of events, sorry. All right, for everybody knows, the Community Action Coalition is hosting in this building a call to conversation on Thursday the 5th at 6:30, and it's going to be a discussion about social media, believe it or not. Even the board sometimes gets social media messed up. So not only our students, adults, everybody can come and take some advantage from this. It's the opportunity to sit down with people from the community. Anything else as far as calendar of events?
It's not a calendar, but that's something I just want to report on. I attended the foundation meeting last week as the alternate, and just wanted to make the board aware. The foundation did have a successful month in bond sale, and just publicly I'd like to thank everyone who was a part of that. And we've been working on supporting the Mountain Bond Sale. It's very successful. The foundation has a pot of money that they fund special projects out of. In our last meeting, we funded 3 of those special projects, one being that we're going to continue the bus transportation on a biweekly basis at High School North for tutoring. The other is that we supply money for dialogue day sponsorship for the Community Coalition that will be held, I believe it's in February. And also we gave funding for the robotics competition. One of the most important things is the Teacher Foundation grant applications are out. They're due back to the foundation on November 16th. The committee, there's a committee that will be together and read those grants, make the awards. That's going to be done on, at this point, on November 23rd, unless that gets changed, but I don't think so. And then the awards will be given out to teachers and staff on December 11th. So please, anyone that's hearing this that has contact with teachers, it's really important that teachers write these grants. The money is there, and we're ready to give it out. I know the last couple of years, we didn't give out our full amount that we had budgeted because we didn't get that many applications sent. And that, to me, as a foundation member, as a community member, is disheartening. It takes a few minutes to write a grant, and the teacher can get up to $2,000 for something extra in our classroom. So we'd like to remind everyone of that. Our Daddy Daughter Dance is scheduled for February 5th and 6th. Tickets are on sale soon, and they sell out fast. So if you need daddies, you have to take daughters to the Daddy Daughter Dance. Get your ticket early. That's all.
Anything else on events or events at your campus?
Is it, John, does anybody have the dates? There's two veterans, adult celebration, one at South River and one at East. Do we have those dates? That's the winner and
they came out in the notes.
The honor fest is on Wednesday, the 11th, on actual veterans.
On actual veterans, yeah, Wednesday, 11th.
Those 46, yes.
Okay.
And it's in High School North, is there a salute to vets, and that's actually this Thursday.
What about South River's having one too?
All the students, do you know that they have that one? I had to double check.
I didn't want to miss that one. It was a nice car set up to us tonight. I don't
have to take it. You sent those to
me. Absolutely. I do believe it is actually on Veterans Day, but I'll double check that, sir.
Okay.
All right. Next on the agenda is closed session. Is there a motion to go into closed session?
Make a motion that we go into closed session for the purpose of attorney-client privilege.
Is there a second?
Support on the motion.
If we have a second, a motion and support, is there any discussion on the motion?
What if we're going into attorney-client privilege for?
Well, we can't talk about that in public, but when we get into closed session,
but according to our policy, we are supposed to have documents that we need in order to participate in the meeting, and there were no documents supplied for a closed session under the confidential file or any other file. So how is this not a violation of our bylaws?
Yeah, we've had this conversation a few times. We don't post attorney-client privilege letters to Edu Portal, so those are not available. Those are distributed at the closed session meeting, and then we
go. But according to our policy, Mrs. Johnson, according to our policy, we are supposed to have the documents that we need prior to the meeting in order to participate in the meeting.
What policy are you discussing?
People may be looking at for you, but probably you can look at just as easily as me.
I mean, motion to
call the question. Okay, the question. Roll call, please.
So how is this not a violation of our policy?
You haven't stated what policy it is, so I have nothing to look at.
You don't know our policy at all?
So, if you look it up, I'll look it up. If you don't, we're going to go on.
Okay. Okay. I just know everyone in this room votes for the support of my member. She's acting everything where is my policy. So I suggest that if we bring something up that's related to policy, that we need to provide what the policy number is.
Exactly.
That would make the meeting go so much easier and things.
Okay.
So I'm very
sure. Madam Secretary, please do a roll call vote.
Mrs. McClatcher?
Yes.
Mr. Hoover?
Yes.
Mrs. Sergio?
Yes.
Mrs. Weinberger?
Yes.
Mrs. Olson?
No, we're violating policy.
We're not violating policy for closed session, aren't we?
Go ahead, please finish the vote.
Sorry.
Mrs. Ross votes yes. Mr. Hubler?
Yes. We are moving in closed session, 8:58. We will adjourn and come back in session.
Motion to adjourn.
Second. Any discussion? No discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Adjourn.